back and forget what time church starts. So it is 5 minutes late. I apologize. But I was having such a joy getting to catch up with some of you this morning, so I don't regret it that much. So as we are coming together, I will commend you to the white folded sheet in your bulletin for your announcements. We're not going to go over them in depth, because I know you can read. But I will remind you that if you are doing cool things or boring things or any things this summer, you should take pictures of it and send in little stories to Ms. Velma Durant to be featured in the newsletters throughout the winter so that we can remember our summers fondly. The other thing you can do is post them on your social media accounts with the hashtag Salem Summer. And then that will be an easy way for someone like me or someone else to go through and search all those tags and have all of our summer adventures pop up together. So you may notice I've been going through and commenting on people's things, hashtag Salem Summer, just so that they become searchable for the rest of us. And then the other thing that I will make note of is on the back of the announcements, there is an Only Help update. I know this church has been really involved in Only Help throughout the years, so if you want to know what's going on and what you can do, that is there on the back page. All right, and with that, it is time for us to go to God in prayer. I invite you to stand if that is what connects you. Or you can remain seated and be mindful as I will lead you through our body prayer movements. If moving is what helps you to connect with God, then I invite you to follow along. Otherwise, just be in a state of prayer as we are inviting God into this worship with us. So we are not just showing up and snapping our fingers and expecting to be ready for worship. We are showing up and preparing to come into God's presence. So will you pray with me? As we've been doing, we will raise our arms to welcome God in. You can bring your hands to your heart to feel a sense of gratitude for God's presence. And again, we'll welcome God. As you bring your hands to your heart, feel gratitude. And then we'll add on as we welcome God. Thank you. ourselves into your presence. We ask, O God, that we would all be open and ready and prepared to worship you with our hearts and minds and bodies and souls. In your name we pray. Amen. Now I invite you to sing number 404, Every Time I Feel the Spirit. Remember, masks on for singing. And I'm going to go find my mask while you guys start singing. Starting a sermon series on the Lord's Prayer. This is a prayer that many of us know. There are two versions in Scripture, one in Matthew and one in Luke. We are doing the Matthew version. It is not exactly what you'll know from the Lord's Prayer that we say each Sunday, but this is where it comes from. So here now the words from Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 to 13. This is Jesus talking. Pray then in this way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. This is the word of God for the people.
Thanks be to God.
Did it feel kind of weird not hearing the ending of the prayer the way we say it? That's what the scripture says, though. That's what's there. So this is our Lord's Prayer. Many of us have memorized it since childhood. And if you haven't memorized it since childhood, that's okay. You're in good company. Many people who start attending a church later in life ended up memorizing it at that point, or just hearing people saying this thing all together. What are they doing saying that? And then perhaps you decided, ooh, I better figure out what that is. memorized it in church or in a context that says it with slightly different words. We all have debts and trespasses, right? Or in a slightly different rhythm. I noticed I say it in a different rhythm than many of you, and so I'll catch myself tripping up at the end, trying to figure out where I'm supposed to put my pauses so that we all match up and say it in unison. Of all the things to worry about, right? But we worry about these things when we're saying something that everyone else seems to know. It's one of the iconic prayers. It's like the 23rd Psalm. It's something that may remain with you even when your memory starts to fail. Some church rituals, like rote prayers or scripture reciting or taking communion, remain in our muscle memory even when time takes away the memory of even our loved ones. I've seen this. People can remember how to take communion even if they don't remember their children's names. So for the next 3 weeks, we're going to focus on the Lord's Prayer. It's such a deep, wonderful prayer that we really could talk about it for much longer. Instead, today we're going to do an overview, and then on the next 2 weeks, we'll focus on just two pieces. So if there's something today that sticks out to you that you're like, got to know more about that, you better let me know. Time is limited, but I'm happy to address things in the next couple weeks as well. I have other thoughts too, but you know, this is the kind of prayer that catches our imagination. And if you're thinking, what is she talking about? It's just a prayer that we say on Sunday morning. You're going to hang on to your seat, because that's the thing about rote prayers. Sometimes we lose the thread. We lose the meaning, and we just say it. But that doesn't mean that's all that there is. So I want you to take a moment. I want you to think back to the first time that you were aware of the Lord's Prayer. Was someone teaching it to you? Were you hearing other people say it? What is your earliest Lord's Prayer? Do you already know it at this point? Have you ever stopped to go through it line by line by line to think about what each of these things mean, what you're really praying for? Some people have used this prayer as a template for how to pray, going from the Our Father to the Thine is the Kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. So today we're going to do Lectio Divina. If you haven't done that with us before, then what that means is we're going to go through the text just a couple lines at a time. I'm going to give you things to think about, and you're going to let your biblical imagination go to work. I really want you to listen for personal pronouns, like I or me. And I want you to listen to where God's grace is within the prayer. So once we get to the end, I'm going to read the whole scripture through again, and I can almost guarantee that you're going to hear it in a completely new way. So let this be prayerful. Let this be focused. Let this be restorative. And let this be holy. Take a deep breath. Listen. Our Father. What is a holy heavenly Father? What is the ideal Father? the song goes, "All I know is I'm not home yet. This is not where I belong. Take this world and give me Jesus. This is not where I belong." It's beautiful and it's catchy.
I think Democrats have very much that nature. You say,
but
isn't
it? Also debtors. Yikes. Have you ever noticed that? It just takes for granted that we will be people who forgive others. People who don't hold grudges or debts. And it's a tricky thing, because sometimes we're holding grudges because we were genuinely hurt or abused. People would say we have every right to not forgive. Sometimes our situation is so extreme that forgiveness feels like capitulation or saying that they have a right to hurt us. But I don't think that's what this means. If you are holding a grudge or struggling to forgive, then if it's safe for you, I invite you to bring it for them to mind right now. And now I invite you to imagine God's peace flowing into you. Perhaps it feels like warm light. Perhaps it's a cozy hug wrapped around you. Maybe a shield, armor. Maybe it's a puppy sitting in your lap. What they did, their sin, is still there. But now, between you and them is God, filled with peace and love. I think that's what forgiveness can feel like. It's not about them. It's about being free in God's peace. Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. Because we too are forgiven. Listen, and do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. In our version it says, lead us not into temptation and deliver us from evil. What tempts you? What tempts you really? I'm not talking about the cookies, you know, unless you have an eating disorder. But I'm talking about temptations like comfort in the face of injustice, about choosing easy solutions that hurt others. I'm talking about addictions and recovery. I'm talking about abusing your body for the sake of your pride. I'm talking about trying to separate out faith from our minute-to-minute decisions or even out of our big decisions. What tempts you? And then this version of our scripture ends with a plea for rescue. What evil do we need rescue from? Take a deep breath. This is our scripture. This is the basis for the prayer that we say every Sunday. This is the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples when they just needed something, for when they had no idea what to pray. Did you notice the personal pronouns? There aren't any. This is not an I prayer. This is a we prayer. This isn't about just you or me. It's about us, all of us. When you pray this prayer, it's about all the people that you know and all the people that you don't know, all the people you like and about all the people that you hate. Sure, you can try to be selective in your mind. You know, I just want to pray we about Salem, right? But what if God is the one who decides where the cap is on me? So let's listen together once more, and then I'll invite you to join me in prayer. Listen. Pray then this way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. Let us stand and pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. away from me, a big thank you to Betty Ambrose and Alan Miller for leading worship last week. So after the long vacation, I heard him sing with lovely and blessed people. So thank you for doing that. We have a prayer concern from Janice, her friend
Christ,
who is in the hospital with an unknown cause and is currently incoherent. And a prayer from Vern that is, thank you for all the healing blessings for Jared, Becky, Jim Holland, Jim Hitchcock, and Gloria, all recovering from serious illnesses following much prayer. Praise be to God. Amen. What else can we be praying for each other? You give us all goodness, all grace. We ask, O God, that we would be people of your compassion and grace, that we would be people who trust in you for healing, that we would be people who know you and proclaim you where we go in our words or in our actions. God, we ask that you would help us and help our world and all our natural disasters that just seem to be getting worse. We ask, O God, that you would help us to plan accordingly and to help those who are struggling and suffering. God, for the people who are sick or in the hospital, we ask that you would surround them with the best wisdom of doctors, and that they would be well rested and able to think clearly when diagnosing and solving problems. And God, we ask that you would be with us in all the unspoken prayers of our hearts, in all the times when we don't know what to pray, in all the times when we pray, but we pray for what we should not. We ask, O God, that you would be merciful to us, and that as the Spirit comes up from within us and translates, that you would take that, not just our words. Amen.
Thank you.
compassionate. Help us to work together, O God, to make a difference in our place in your world. In your name we pray. Amen. Our final song is one of my favorites. It is 405, Seek Ye First. Peace.